Alleluia.
This morning, we're continuing in a series in the Gospel of John that's titled Multiply Life. Today, we're going to be reading the final portion of chapter 7, verses 40 to 52. So if you have a Bible, you can turn there. Today, we're entering back into a passage where the people are wondering, who is Jesus? But as we read this morning, I would like you to watch for how the revelation of who Jesus is leads you and I into unexpected opportunities today. At the end of our sermon, we're going to then have some very practical training on a way that we can walk with Jesus into those unexpected opportunities around us. So if you would please stand with me, we're going to read from John chapter 7, starting in verse 37. And we'll read to verse 52 this morning. The Gospel according to John. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. On hearing his words, some of the people said, "Surely this man is the prophet." Others said, "He is the Messiah." Still others said, "How can the Messiah come from Galilee? Does not Scripture say that the Messiah will come from David's descendants and from Bethlehem, the town where David lived?" Thus the people were divided because of Jesus. Some wanted to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him. Finally, the temple guards went back to the chief priests and the Pharisees, who asked them, "Why didn't you bring him in?" "No one ever spoke the way this man does," the guards replied. "You mean he has deceived you also?" the Pharisees retorted. "Have any of the rulers or of the Pharisees believed in him?" "No, but this mob who knows nothing of the law, there is a curse on them." Nicodemus, who had gone to Jesus earlier and who was one of their own number, asked, "Does our law condemn a man without first hearing him to find out what he has been doing?" They replied, "Are you from Galilee too? Look into it, and you will find that a prophet does not come out of Galilee." Father, we thank you for your word. It is a gift to us. Holy Spirit, we welcome you now to transform us by your presence and by the word. We invite you, change us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. When I read this passage, I think of Christie's grandfather, Arthur. Now, Arthur has since passed away, but he was a legend in our family. You see, Arthur was a master checker player. He could beat anybody at the game of checkers. When someone would play against him, you thought you were doing great. It was this constant back and forth. Arthur would take one of your checkers and you would take two of his. But then along the way, you would somehow miss a move. He would set up the unexpected, and miraculously, you would watch his checker jump all around the board. It would land in front of you, and he would say with a smile on his face, "King me." A bit more back and forth, and suddenly, he was the victor. You thought you had a chance to beat him, but there was no chance at all. Unexpected moves led to his victory. In this passage we read this morning, there is this constant back and forth leading to more unexpected moves that in the end point to Jesus as the victor. Just prior to this, the Jewish officials tried to arrest Jesus, but we read in verse 30 that they could not seize him. The crowds kept wondering, is he a deceiver? Is he the Messiah? Is he a prophet? Is he dangerous? By verse 40, they say, he is the prophet. Others say he is the Messiah. But others wonder about his birthplace. The people are divided. There is this back and forth about Jesus. Then the Pharisees send out the temple guards to arrest Jesus again. They have him this time. He's cornered. It is time they can take him. But then we read that they came back empty-handed. No one ever spoke to us like he does, they said. We can't arrest him. Even Nicodemus, one of their own, raises a question about whether Jesus is being fairly heard or not. There are twists and turns, unexpected outcomes. Yet these unexpected outcomes in Jesus' words and in his way teach us who he is and what he leads us into today. Jesus leads us into the unexpected with his authority as resurrection people empowered by the Holy Spirit. This is the unexpected surprise that our chaotic world needs so desperately for you and I to live out in front of their eyes. So what helps us to live out these unexpected opportunities? Let's look at three ideas from this text. We start in verses 38 to 39. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. The first idea in walking out the unexpected in Jesus is to see that the Holy Spirit is given. Here we're reaching back into last week's sermon, but it's a vital point that we must linger on for a bit again. Jesus directs us to the living water that will flow from within believers. And John adds for us that this is found in the Holy Spirit who was given after Jesus was glorified. The Holy Spirit refreshes us and empowers us for living out life in Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit draws us to faith. He transforms us. He brings new life to us. He is the very presence of God dwelling in us. He places his seal of assurance on us, and he leads us in growing in the ways of Jesus. When we understand this, we have different eyes to see the world around us. We no longer see with just physical eyes like those in John 7 continue to do. Rather, we are given spiritual eyes to see the more, the unexpected that God is doing all around us. Our eyes are open to no longer look to the kingdoms of this world, but to look for God's kingdom that is advancing and expanding all around us. The Holy Spirit gives us eyes of faith and a heart of love to see the kingdom that Jesus proclaimed and to keep on acting out his love in a broken world. One of the things that is on everybody's mind these days, it seems, is the United States presidential campaign. At least everybody keeps coming to me and saying, what do you think? And who are you voting for? And I can't answer that. Who knows? But what I can tell you is that there are two deeply flawed candidates who are at the center of the United States election. With physical eyes, it looks hopeless. Physical eyes, you see, tell me to vote in a candidate who will build up my kingdom and build up my party's kingdom and build up America's kingdom. But the Spirit empowers us to ask different questions. What would advance God's kingdom? What would demonstrate God's truth, his grace, mercy, and compassion to citizens and to strangers? You see, the Holy Spirit gives us different eyes for our world. He opens up an entirely different idea of reality. Notice also Jesus' words about his hour and his time not yet having arrived. When he talks about it in verses 6 and 7, he says, "My time is not yet here." Here he used the word kairos for time. But in Greek, there are two words for time. There is the word kairos, and then there's another word that is chronos. Chronos is a definite time, ticking away in seconds, minutes, hours, and days. That's why on my watch, I have a stopwatch that is labeled chronos, because it's ticking away in milliseconds and seconds and minutes and hours. But the word that Jesus used here was not chronos, it was kairos. This word means the right time or the opportune time, the God-ordained time. You see, while the officials believed it was the time to arrest Jesus, it was not the right time. In God's picture, it was not the right time in His time frame. Later in God's time, they would arrest and crucify Jesus. But God's time is different than our time. The Holy Spirit enables us to see with different eyes. He is expanding His kingdom in ways we cannot see with our physical eyes, with our physical senses. He is working by His time, in His timing, in ways we cannot imagine. Praise God that He has given us His Spirit to guide us in His way and in His time. He opens our eyes, pulling back the curtain just to give us a glimpse of what He is doing and so that we can trust in His perspective rather than our own. We walk out the unexpected by knowing that the Holy Spirit has been given. This morning, are you walking in step with the Spirit, fully, intentionally submitted to Him and His ways? The second idea, verses 40 to 46. On hearing His words, some of the people said, "Surely this man is the prophet." Others said, "He is the Messiah." Still others asked, "How can the Messiah come from Galilee? Does not Scripture say that the Messiah will come from David's descendants and from Bethlehem, the town where David lived?" Thus the people were divided because of Jesus. Some wanted to seize Him, but no one laid a hand on Him. Finally, the temple guards went back to the chief priests and the Pharisees, who asked them, "Why didn't you bring Him in?" "No one ever spoke the way this man does," the guards replied. Walking out the unexpected in Jesus, we see that Jesus has authority. The unexpected here is the authority that Jesus walks in. And that authority still amazes people today. The people had thoughts about who Jesus was. He is dangerous. He's a prophet. He's the Messiah. How could He be the Messiah? They said, "Scripture says," and then they would give their own interpretation. Everyone had a viewpoint, and the people were divided in their opinions about who He was. But notice what happened to the temple guards. These men had authority. They were sent out by the chief priests and the Pharisees, men with the full authority of the temple. These guards needed to obey the orders that had been given to them by the authority. But something unexpected happened. They could not arrest Jesus. In verses 45 to 46, they report back to the chief priests about why it is that they disobeyed a direct order. All they can say is, "No one ever spoke to us the way this man does." Jesus still meets people in unexpected ways. Think about who people say Jesus was even today. Some say teacher, some say prophet, some a miracle worker. Others say he's a liar or he's a fraud. But then there are those who have eyes to see Jesus' full authority, and they're amazed. They're intrigued about His words, His works, His lifestyle, His love, His kindness, His authority. They shake their heads in wonder like the guards. You see, they came to put Jesus in His place, But they left wondering about who this great one is. Jesus' authority is what leaves me amazed today too. When we walk in his authority, others become surprised too. Our aim is to help others to see Jesus for who he is so that they might be amazed as well. This leads to two ideas for us to consider here. One, we can expect Jesus' authority in our lives. Jesus' authority caught the guards by surprise. They saw something unexpected in him. As Jesus' followers, we expect others to see a similar, unexpected authority as we live Jesus out to them. May they not see our actions, but may they see our Master's actions. Because we live life in the authority of our Master Jesus, not our own authority. Secondly, we are to help others to meet Jesus. Our aim is to not simply sit around and talk about Jesus. Rather, we want others to see him for who he truly is. I once heard about a group of Jehovah's Witnesses who were going door to door in a neighborhood. One guy who lived in that neighborhood, he knew Jesus very well, and he loved him deeply. However, when the Jehovah's Witnesses came to his door, his neighbor noticed that this guy locked himself in his house and hid, pretending to not be home. So his neighbor later decided to call him on it. He went to him and he said, "Why did you hide when the Jehovah's Witnesses came to your door?" His answer was, "I don't know much about Jehovah's Witnesses and what they believe, so I chose to not engage with them." Listen to the neighbor's reply. He said, "You don't have to be an expert on Jehovah's Witnesses. You are not called to teach them about how to be a better Jehovah's Witness. Your aim is to share who Jesus is. You know Jesus, so share him. Point the way to Jesus and let Jesus amaze them." People have many thoughts about who Jesus is. But may we live in a way that people see him for who he truly is. It is not our words that convince them. Rather, that it is his authoritative presence that they cannot resist. We simply bring people to Jesus and we watch the encounter unfold. So we walk out the unexpected as we see the Holy Spirit's presence. As we walk in Jesus' authority, the last idea, verses 47 to 52. "You mean he has deceived you also," the Pharisees retorted. "Have any of the rulers or the Pharisees believed in him? No, but this mob that knows nothing of the law, there is a curse on them." Nicodemus, who had gone to Jesus earlier and who was one of their own number, asked, "Does our law condemn a man without first hearing him to find out what he has been doing?" They replied, "Are you from Galilee too? Look into it, and you will find that a prophet does not come out of Galilee." Walking out the unexpected in Jesus, we see that Jesus rises up. He is risen. While we might not see it at first glance, this passage has a lot to say about new life and the resurrection hope that Jesus brings. Nicodemus asked his fellow religious teachers to reconsider their judgment of Jesus. He wanted the facts about Jesus to come out, for Jesus to have the opportunity to defend himself to them about who he is. Nicodemus, like the temple guards, sees Jesus differently. While Nicodemus is a religious official, he also is an admirer of Jesus. In chapter 3, we see where Nicodemus goes to meet with Jesus under the cover of darkness. In chapter 19, we see great signs about Nicodemus being a Jesus follower. But the officials will not accept testimony, nor will they even follow their own laws as keepers of the law. Their minds are closed. Their eyes are blind, their ears are deaf, their hearts are hard. They cannot see with spiritual eyes. And then we come to verse 52. Here, the English Standard Version seems to be a much better translation that expresses John's point. We read the official's response. They say, "Search and see that no prophet arises from Galilee." This phrase, "arises from," needs more attention. This is the same word that John used to describe the resurrection of Jesus. John is already here pointing us towards the vital truth that in Jesus is new life and resurrection. But the officials are so closed off that they cannot see this new life that's being extended to them. They are so incensed that they cannot see God's redemption, and so they make a critical judgment. They first miss the detail about Jesus being born in Bethlehem, a very important detail. And then they say, "No prophet arises from Galilee." The religious leaders overstate their point in order to discredit Jesus. In their blind desire to prove their point, they got the wrong answer. But it happens to the best of us, doesn't it? We like to use phrases like "everyone" or "no one" in order to prove our point and try to shame others into thinking the way we do. Maybe you don't, but I do, so... But no matter how much shame they try to apply, the religious leaders are dead wrong. They claim that no prophet comes out of Galilee. But in reality, there were two significant prophets who arose from Galilee. One was Jonah, and the other was Hosea. The interesting thing is that in both of these prophets, we see strong themes of resurrection and new life. John chapter 1, verse 17. "Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights." 3 days and three nights, as good as dead in the belly of the fish. This theme that runs through Jonah, foreshadowing Jesus' resurrection. The second prophet is Hosea. Hosea chapter 6, verse 2, "After 2 days he will revive us. On the third day he will restore us that we may live in his presence." Hosea in chapter 6 foretells a messianic redemption to come, a resurrection, a restoration that we know to have been fulfilled in Jesus' resurrection from the dead. John moves us beyond the idea that Jesus is a prophet to point toward the resurrected one, the one in whom we have hope and new life. His resurrection changes everything for our present and our future. So consider for a moment these three ideas that have been put forth. The Holy Spirit has been given, Jesus has authority, and Jesus is resurrected. These three give us a new hope for how we live our lives today. We have authority as a resurrection people who are empowered by the Holy Spirit. This is our new, unexpected reality that changes everything around us. Consider this story. Recently, I received an email from a friend of mine. He talked about a colleague who had just contacted him. This colleague was an outspoken atheist, had been an outspoken atheist for the whole time he knew him. But this guy recently found out that a family member of his has cancer. This atheist reached out to my friend and he asked him for prayer. You see, he had seen the witness of Jesus in my friend. He had seen the authority of Jesus in his life. And now, in his darkest time of need, when he had nowhere else to turn, an outspoken atheist said, "Would you pray for my family?" We never fully know what God is going to do in someone's life, so we partner with him in the unexpected. Our practical expressions help others around us to see the unexpected Jesus. This morning, I would like to teach us another practical way to show Jesus to those around us. And it is found in praying with others. Now, let me ask you this first. Have you ever had someone come to you and say that they were sick or in need? Raise your hand. Good. Most of us. Now, how many of you have ever said, "I'll pray for you"? Yeah, most of us. I won't ask the follow-up question. That question is, how many of you actually remember to pray for them? Because I'll be honest with you. People come to me and they say, "I have a need," and the first thing that comes out of my mouth is, "I'll pray for you." But let me be honest for a minute, I rarely do it. I'm sorry if I promise to pray for you. I forget. I mean the best when I say it, but then it gets crowded out by other things. I don't seem to get around to praying. But what if instead we took a moment right then and there to start a conversation between God and the person who is right in front of us, inviting Jesus to do the unexpected in the life of someone who is standing right there? Imagine with me a scenario for a minute. Emmanuel sits beside you at work. And while you're eating lunch one day, you look at him and you say, "So how you doing?" His response back is, "I'm not sleeping well," or "I've got a really bad Gunfan," or "My child is sick," or "My marriage is on the edge of disaster." And what you could say is, "I'm so sorry to hear that. I'll pray for you." And then keep going, right? We do that. Or because you are part of a resurrection people with authority who is empowered by the Holy Spirit, you could say, "Could I ask Jesus to touch that need?" You mean right now? Yeah, right now. Could I ask Jesus to touch that need right now? And many people will take you up on the offer. We can seek Jesus to do the unexpected in someone's life. This is simple. No yelling, no screaming, no need for big words, no sermon, no need to take up an offering. You are just going to start a three-way conversation between your loving Father, the other person, and yourself. I'd like to just quickly teach us five steps that we can follow in this. These aren't magical steps, but they're just ideas that can help us along the way in praying for others. The first thing we can do is to ask, "What would you like Jesus to do?" Someone tells us what's wrong, and we can just simply say to them, "What would you like Jesus to do for you?" If you could ask Him, what would you ask Him for? And then listen to the person's request as you pray for them. Remember to pray for that need that they just said to you. So we ask the person. Secondly, we ask the Holy Spirit. We ask the Holy Spirit, what is the cause? We don't do this out loud, by the way. This is internal now. You dialogue with the Holy Spirit here. What is the cause? Why is this person hurting? Are there other things I should pray for too? What might the Holy Spirit want to unexpectedly say to this person today? And we begin to listen to the Holy Spirit. So we ask the person, we ask the Holy Spirit, and then we discern, how should I pray? What's going on here? Do I need to pray to have to tell the demonic to leave? Do I need to pray for physical healing? Do I need to pray for this person's emotional being? Do I need to pray for this person to understand forgiveness? Do I need to lead this person in a prayer of repentance? Here's the deal. If you're a follower of Jesus, the Holy Spirit is in you, and the Holy Spirit is there to speak to you, and the Holy Spirit can lead you to discern what He wants to do in this person's life in front of you. We ask the person, we ask the Holy Spirit, we discern, then we pray, watch, and listen. We start praying, but keep your eyes open. I know that goes against every religious message you've ever heard in your life. We're supposed to fold our hands, close our eyes, bow our head. Keep your eyes open while you pray. Watch for signs that God is touching this person. Stay open to what the Holy Spirit, not you, might want to say to this person. Ask Jesus to touch them. Pray encouragement and blessing over them. And as you're closing up, ask them if they feel anything. You want to know if God is touching them. If He is, you want to keep praying for them in even more informed ways, because we expect that He wants to do the unexpected in this person's life. We ask the person, we ask the Holy Spirit, we discern, we pray, watch, and listen, and then we say amen, and we encourage further action. Encourage a person to keep seeking prayer. If they do not know Jesus, ask them if they would like to know Him, especially if they've been touched in this time of prayer. Encourage them to seek friends or to move towards reconciliation, to get involved in a small group of people who are studying God's Word together. This is not a time for counseling, but if you have an idea for someone, a next step they could take that would help them in their walk with God, then share it with them. But above all, help them to know that you care for them and God cares for them too, and He wants to know them. It sounds kind of scary, but it works. God provides us with divine appointments, unexpected opportunities where He wants to use you and I in order to touch someone else. And praying for others is just one way He does so. He uses it. He uses you and I. He gives us the privilege of watching Him break into other people's lives at unexpected times and in unexpected ways. This week, how will Jesus lead us into the unexpected with His authority as resurrection people, empowered by the Holy Spirit? May we stay open to Him. I would ask you to stand. We're going to call the worship team back, and I'll just share with you one last story. In one church, we would go out week after week into one of the poorest sections of our city. We would go into the government housing projects. And what we would do is something very simple. We would take a couple of bags of milk. We would take some bread. We'd take some eggs. And we would go door to door, and we'd knock on the door. And when somebody came, we would say, "Hey, we're out in the neighborhood today handing out free food. Wanted to know if you could use some free food." And I'll tell you, about 100% of the people took us up on it. They're like, "Free food? Absolutely, I'll take some of that." They would ask us, "Why are you doing it?" And we would just say, "It's just a simple, practical way to show you God's love." Then, while we're standing there, we would say to them, "While we're here, can we pray a blessing over your house?" And almost 100% of them would say, "Absolutely." So we would pray a deeply, deeply spiritual prayer. The prayer was, "Jesus, please bless this house and everyone who lives here. Amen." Tough, right? I mean, that's deep, deep. When we're finished praying that prayer, we would then follow it up and we would say, "Is there anything else we can pray for today?" Many people would open up right there to complete strangers, and they would say, "Please pray I get a job," or "Please pray for my family member," or "Please pray for this thing that's coming up in our lives." And we would pray for them, and the next time we're in a neighborhood, we'd stop in and say, "Hey, anything happen after we prayed for you?" This one day, we knocked on the door, and this woman came to the door. She was Latino. They were only Spanish speakers, so I was so happy to have a friend with me who spoke Spanish. We went through this whole deal, and then we asked the question, "Is there anything else we can pray for?" And she said, "Sure, I'd love you to pray for my mom. She's sick." And we said, "Okay, we can do that." And as soon as we said that, she is grabbing us by the arm, and she's pulling us into the house. She pulls us into their living room, into their salon, and there in the middle of the living room is this woman who is dying in a hospital bed. And I thought to myself, when I said I would pray for your mom, I had no idea she was this sick. But okay, we'll do it anyways. and we prayed together. And you know, I wish I could share with you, I could say, yeah, and all of a sudden the mother, she jumped out of her bed and she ran around the room. That's not what happened. But what I can tell you happened is the felt presence, the tangible presence of the living God came into that room on that woman and on that family. They were deeply, deeply moved as the peace of God settled there. What an amazing privilege it is. As people of the resurrection, people to whom Jesus has given his authority, we walk in his authority. People empowered by the Holy Spirit. What an amazing privilege to step into these unexpected opportunities, these times when with physical eyes we can't see anything at all going on, but our God is at work. And may we say yes to what he's doing and just partner with him in it.